Hello everybody, we are going to discuss about one of the important phenomenon associated with cells, that is plasmolysis. Process of plasmolysis with reference to plant cells. In plant cells, a rigid cell wall is present over the cell membrane. You have a cell membrane. Over the cell membrane, a very rigid cell wall is present. Because of the complex structure of the cell wall is very rigid. So that surrounds the cell membrane. Such cells, when placed in a strong solution, eliminate water due to osmosis. Now, if you place these plant cells in a strong solution, that means it has to be hypertonic solution. So, if a plant cell is placed in a hypertonic solution or a strong salt solution or a strong sugar solution, then what is going to happen? From the plant cells, water will be lost. Water will be lost into the surrounding medium. That process takes place by osmosis. We call it as exo-osmosis because the water is moving out of the cell. Due to this, the cell shows shrinkage of protoplasm. Protoplasm, which includes cytoplasm, nucleus, etc., away from the cell wall. That is, the cell wall remained at its original place, but plasma membrane and inner contents show shrinkage. So, as soon as the cell is placed in a hypertonic solution, what is going to happen? The water content will be lost from the protoplasm, and as a result of that, the protoplasm is going to shrink. Protoplasm is bounded by the cell membrane, so cell membrane will move away from the cell wall. The cell wall is going to remain in its own place. I repeat the line once again. Due to this, the cell shows shrinkage of protoplasm. The protoplasm is going to shrink away from the cell wall. From the cell wall it will come out. That is, cell wall remain at its own place. Cell wall will be in its own place. But plasma membrane and inner contents of the cell show shrinkage. So when the protoplasm is shrinking up, protoplasm is bounded by the cell membrane. So that is also going to shrink. This entire phenomenon is known as plasmolysis. We see the phenomenon once again in a figure. Here you see the stages of plasmolysis. You have a normal cell, cells having cytoplasm, nucleus, properly defined cell. Now the cell is placed in a hypertonic solution. Slowly and steadily, exosmosis is taking place. That means the water is moving out of the cell. Water is moving out of the cell. And at last, what is happening? Shrinkage of the protoplasm bounded by the cell membrane is happening. The cell wall remains in its own place. That is all about the stages of plasmolysis. Now we have an activity. What is the aim of the activity? To demonstrate that plasmolysis takes place only in living cells. Plasmolysis takes place only in living cells. That we have to demonstrate. In the first stage, what we are doing, we mount the peel of a rio leaf in water on a slide. We are mounting a peel of a rio leaf in water on a slide and examine the cells under high power of a microscope. We observe small little granules called chloroplasts containing pigments, that is chlorophyll. So if you observe it, you will find fully turgid conditions. Fully turgid cells will be observed. That means the cells will be proper here. You will have fully turgid cells. Fully turgid cells will be observed. Alright. Now if you put a strong solution of salt or sugar on the mounted leaf on the slide and wait for a few minutes, just you need to do one thing. whatever slide you have prepared, whatever mount of the rheo leaf you have prepared, on that you are putting solution of salt or sugar and you have to wait for a few minutes. We observe that the contents of the cell shrinks away from the cell wall. The contents will shrink away from the cell wall. So this is when it is placed in hypertonic solution. After putting it in hypertonic solution, shrinkage of the protoplasm is seen here. The cell is shrinking here. This was before plasmolysis. This is after plasmolysis. So shrinkage is seen. This is the first stage of activity 1. We go to the stage 2. What we are doing, to start with, we place some rheo leaves in boiling water. We take some boiling water in a test tube or in a beaker, and there you can put some rheo leaves. When you put the rheo leaves in boiling water for a few minutes, this will kill the cells. Obviously, the cells will be destroyed. After that, mount the pill of one such leaf. You take one such leaf, make a mount of that pill of one such leaf and observe it under a microscope. Thereafter, you are observing it under a microscope. Put a strong solution of salt or sugar in the mounted leaf on the slide. We wait for a few minutes and observe it under a microscope again. Now, this time, upon observation, it is found that plasmolysis does not take place in this mounted leaf. In stage 1, we saw the process of plasmolysis. In stage 2, basically because of one reason, we have boiled the rheo leaf, or we have placed the rheo leaf in boiling water, and thereafter we are making a mount of the pill. Because of that reason, you are not able to see the process of plasmolysis here. So what conclusion can be drawn? Only living cells are able to show osmosis as well as plasmolysis, because only such cells have selectively permeable membrane. As soon as you boil the leaf becomes dead, and when the leaf becomes dead, the semi-permeable nature of the plasma membrane is destroyed. In dead cells, the selective permeability of the cell membrane is destroyed due to denaturation of the proteins. The proteins will be denatured and disassembling of phospholipid units. That means basically the plasma membrane is made up of, you know already, it is made up of phospholipids and proteins. So denaturation of the proteins takes place and disassembling of the phospholipid units takes place. Because of that, the plasma membrane is totally losing its property of selective permeability, and as such, no phenomenon of osmosis and no phenomenon of plasmolysis. That is an activity to show the process of plasmolysis. Now, let us see the role of cell wall in withstanding changes in the surrounding medium. We know that the cell wall is extremely strong, tough. It has got the capability of withstanding changes in the surrounding medium. If any changes takes place in the surrounding medium, with respect to those changes, the cell wall can withstand. Cell walls, because of their rigidity, permit the cells of plants, fungi and bacteria to withstand very dilute, that is hypotonic, external media without bursting. Now, if you put an animal cell, say an RBC, you are putting it in water, it is hypotonic solution, what is going to happen? Water is going to get into the cell, animal cell, and slowly and steadily it is going to bulge out, but the plasma membrane cannot support till a particular extent. After that, because of enormous pressure from inside, the cell is going to burst, the plasma membrane is going to rupture. That is not going to happen over here, because the cell walls are there. Because of their rigidity, they enable the cells of plants, they enable the cells of fungi and bacteria to withstand very dilute or hypotonic external media without getting burst. In such media, the cells tend to take up water by osmosis, that is by endosmosis. Water is getting into the cells, so definitely process of endosmosis. The cells swell, building up pressure against the cell wall. So when the cells are swelling, they will build up pressure against the cell wall. In the outward direction, this is called Turgor pressure. What is it called? Turgor pressure. That means the protoplasmic contents will exert an outward pressure on the cell wall. That outward pressure exerted by the protoplasmic contents on the cell wall is called Turgor pressure. At the same time, the cell wall also exerts an equal pressure against the cell contents of the swollen cell. Now, when the cell wall is being exerted with Turgor pressure, at the same time, the cell wall will also simultaneously exert an opposite pressure on the contents of the cell. This pressure is called wall pressure. So, the pressure exerted by the cell wall on the contents of the cell is called as wall pressure. Thus, because of their cell walls, plant cells can withstand greater changes in the surrounding medium compared to animal cells. Already I have told you, if you put an animal cell, say an RBC you are putting in hypotonic solution, say plain water you are putting, the cell is going to swell, at some point of time it is going to burst, but that is not going to happen here in case of plant cells. So, because of their cell walls, plant cells can withstand greater changes in the surrounding medium compared to the animal cells. If you see the slide, you will be far more clear. Here you see the cell is placed in a, plant cell is placed in a hypotonic solution. When it is placed in a hypotonic solution, water is getting inside. So, Turgor pressure develops. What is that Turgor pressure? Pressure from the inside contents of the cell on the wall, cell wall. That is called Turgor pressure. At the same time, an opposite pressure is being exerted by the cell wall on the contents of the cell. That is called wall pressure. That means the wall pressure will definitely exert in this direction. This is the wall pressure. This is the cell wall. This is the wall pressure. Okay. So, that is how the cell wall is able to manage itself, manage the cell in spite of changes in the external environmental conditions. Thank you.